This talk will be about technologies like Kafka, Kafka Streams, Elasticsearch, and how we use them on a project which we are deploying on Kubernetes. So let's first introduce ourselves. My name is Sander Schoot-Uitenkamp, and I'm IT architect at Alliander.
My name is Jeroen Resort. I'm a consultant working for JDriven, but joined the Alliander project. And first, I would like to ask a question to you. Who is already using Kafka or has used Kafka in the past? Okay.
And is running it in production?
Okay. Who's using Kafka Streams? One or two?
Slightly less. Okay. Okay. Well, let's first introduce Alliander. Alliander is a grid company. We are a semi-governance organization. We have a lot of subsidiary organizations which we use to facilitate and accelerate the energy transition. But the focus of this talk will be about Alliander, which is the grid operator. So what does Alliander do? Alliander maintains the mid and lower voltage electricity grid in parts of the Netherlands. So that's mostly the stuff you don't see and is underground. Same is for gas, we maintain that. So you might have seen our engineers in the street if you have an outage, or for instance, if there is a gas outage, you might have seen some other people. If you have not seen us, then you might be lucky you don't have seen outages in your neighborhood, or you just live in another area and not in our service area. So we only service parts of the Netherlands, and for the other parts, you might have seen our colleagues from Enexis, Stedin, Westland, and some smaller parties. Furthermore, we install a lot of smart meters, and the smart meter will be the context of this talk. We install a lot of them. You might have one already in your home, and we install about 1 million each year. So in 2020, most of the population in the Netherlands will have a smart meter installed. So what does a smart meter do? A smart meter is not very smart, actually. It's just a dumb meter which collects data with the communication interface. So when you want to retrieve data from a smart meter, you can do so at home from your P1 interface, or it could be done by another party like a supplier or an energy consultancy company. So we have a smart meter. The smart meter data is collected by the DSO, which is a distributed system operator. In Dutch, it's called the netbeheerder, and that is the role of Alliander also. And in the Netherlands, we have a central energy data hub, which is called Energy Data Services Nederland. And the role of that hub is so that our suppliers and energy consultancy companies have only one endpoint to collect that data, and they don't have to request the metadata on specific parties. So this it's all about this interface, this project. How does it work? Parties have to send a request for metadata before 9 o'clock, and after 12 o'clock, the head ends of the DSOs will collect that metadata, and usually about 4-6 in the morning, the suppliers and the energy consulting companies can retrieve the data, but it's a batch-wise process, and for us, yeah, there are some issues. So how does it work? EDSN is the central messaging hub, and the DSO has some specific functions which they implement. So they do validation, a bit of enrichment, and each DSO has these functionalities. However, for us, for Alliander, our system which implements these functions, well, it's running against its limitations. So it's less scalable, and well, with our vendor, we are running also against some licensing costs. So we would like to see that better. So our desired situation is we rebuild it using open source as much as possible. We are a governance-owned company, so if we can use open source, we would like to do so as much as possible. And we would like to prepare for a bit less batch processing, and maybe if you send in a request, we can collect the data straight away, and we can answer you straight away. What's also important, like I mentioned, each DSO has these functionalities, and we might transfer, we want to transfer it to EDSN. So if you want to set a new system which makes it possible to do some more streaming, the other DSOs can also benefit from it. So this is the desired situation. We move some parts to EDSN. However, the first year we will be building and hosting this platform. Now, what is important for this platform? Scalability is important. In total, we have millions of households. So daily base, there are millions of messages passing through. And it will only increase as the rollout is only getting started. We have some elasticity because at the moment we have seen a peak at the evening and in the morning. And of course, security is important, and also privacy because the smart meter has been in the news recently. So we started thinking what is important for us if we want to design some new system, what kind of architectural principles can we apply. So we said, well, we want to do some microservice-based technology, we want to use asynchronous, and we want to use a central messaging streaming hub. Well, if we transfer that to a logical architecture, it looks a bit like this. We have a central data hub. At the left, parties can request metadata. At the end, they will retrieve it with the batch interface. And in the middle, we just switched out the implementation with a new streaming engine using specific microservices. So the interface for the other parties will be, unfortunately, will be the same, but in the need, we are ready for the future. So, of course, we have chosen Kafka. This makes no sense because the talk is also about Kafka. But why we have chosen Kafka? Because it's proven technology, at least proven for as much as this kind of technology can be proven. It has support for streaming, so the apps around it and the libraries will support us in doing that. We can have support from the market. It's not a SaaS solution. So if you want some other application, you can think of Amazon Kinesis or some Azure-based platform. It's also do data streaming. But as the hosting was not clear, we wanted to have some solutions that you can host it ourselves. Another way is because we are also using Kafka and Aleander at another department. So talking about Kafka, I think most people already know about what Kafka is. But there is a Kafka environment. So Kafka has a lot of libraries and APIs which you can use. So you have the normal producers and the consumers, and it's just so you can use your Java application to talk to Kafka. But furthermore, Kafka also has the stream processing capability, which is called Kafka Streams, and it's a much richer API. It allows you to do more high-level functions. So you can make use of joins, selects, transformations. It's already there for you, so you don't have to build it yourself. And on the left, you see the connectors. Over there is Kafka Connect. And you can compare Kafka Connect a bit like Logstash or Fluentd. It's an ETL tooling to get data in and out of Kafka. And one of the big differences between Fluentd or Logstash is that Kafka Connect will guarantee delivery, which Logstash or Fluentd, they don't. So what does our entire landscape look like? So we have chosen Kafka as our main data hub. We have chosen Spring Boot for the interfaces, for the batch interface at the left and on the right. The interface with the DSO is also implemented using Spring. Kafka Streams applications that are our workers. We have some front ends, also Spring, a bit of Keycloak for identity management, and for monitoring, and our GUI, our back end, audit tracing, we use Elasticsearch, and some GUIs around it. And now Jeroen is going to talk a bit about Kafka Streams.
Thank you, Sander. Well, I was very excited to join the project because I wasn't familiar yet with Kafka, and when looking into it, it sounded pretty cool. Nice features that sounds fun to work with, and it's always fun to learn something new. So basically, I start with a little introduction. What is Kafka for the people that don't know that yet? Kafka is basically a message log. You just write messages in sequence after each other. You only append, you cannot update or delete these messages. Messages are key-value pair-based. So each message has a key, and most of the time they also have a value. Nice features of Kafka are the high throughput, because we like to have the good performance and scalability for all these smart meters that are going to be installed in the future. Also the fault tolerance attributes are very, very good. How does this work? The high throughput is realized by decoupling the reads from the writes. So you have the producer that appends things to the log, the topic, and the consumers, they don't need to wait for each other. They can just do their reads independently. And also these writes and reads, if you have high volumes, these things are done in batches. So if you insert 1,000 messages, it's not 1,000 calls to the Kafka broker, they will be written in batches. So that's how the high throughput is realized. The good performance is in high throughput, not necessarily in low latency. So for our solution, not online but a batch processing, it's a good match. For low latency solutions, well, it's not necessarily very bad, but well, each time you add another Kafka application in your stream, then you get some latency added. Other attribute, the fault tolerance, is the recovery when a producer or a consumer fails, because and each consumer keeps track Kafka keeps track of each consumer's offset. And consumer commits that periodically. What can happen is that the consumer crashes after processing several messages but not committing yet. When it comes online again, it will resume where the last offset was. So you get some messages. It can be that some messages are processed more than once, but at least once. So for us, for most use cases, that's good enough. Okay. The scalability thing is implemented by doing partitions. So you don't have one log per topic that is appended to, but you can partition that in multiple. You can have 100 partitions if you want, and each partition can be managed independently. So that way you can do scaling and add more consumers. How does that work? For example, you have two applications. Consumer group A is an application, consumer group B is an application. A has two instances and it's reading from four partitions. In that case, the one instance will get will process two of the partitions, the other instance will process two of the other two partitions. But if you have an application that has four consumers, then it's spread across those four consumers. So each consumer only has one partition. You can imagine you can scale this. If you have 100 partitions, you can have up to 100 consumers dividing the work between them. And that way you can do very good vertical scaling. But this talk is not just about Kafka, it's about Kafka Streams. So let's focus on the Kafka Streams API. Like Sander said, it's a more high-level API. There are two parts. You have the stream processors and the K streams. The stream processors is still a streaming API, but you need to do more yourself. The K streams and the K tables, I'll discuss them in the next few slides. These are high-level streams operations that are very powerful, and it just hides a lot of things from a developer. One other thing it's good to know about these Kafka streams. If you're doing joins, if you are combining data from several streams, you are doing that locally in your application. So you need to fetch the data to your application. It's stored locally in either a RocksDB database on disk or in memory. So you're not not continuously querying the Kafka broker for data. You just get the newest data, but keep track of older data that came in. We'll also discuss that in the next few slides. So the difference between a K-stream and a K-table, these are two concepts for the high-level streaming API. A K-stream is basically, a stream with several messages coming in after each other. A K-table is more like a hash map where you insert records, and a new record with the same key will override the previous record with that key. And you use them for different things. Kafka streams have a lot of familiar operations if you're already familiar with the Java streams API. So you can do filtering, you can do mapping, things like that. I'll show some examples of these operations. So let's start with for each we have a Kafka stream called kstream. For each value that comes in, for each key value pair that comes in, we log, oh, I just got a new message. If you want to do some more detailed information, you can, of course, log the content of the message. What's different in this API from the Java stream API is that you can reuse the same stream and do several operations on it. So it's just, you can do both the info and the debug statement and some other things you want to do with the same stream, and it will work. If you do this in the Java streams API, each operation, you can do multiple operations on one stream. A filter. I suppose everybody knows how a filter works. In this case, every message that comes in is held against this filter, so we check whether it's true. If not, the message is filtered out. Now for some more interesting examples, the kstream and the k-table. In the case of a k-table, the data is gathered and stored locally, and because you can spread this around across multiple instances of your application, and each instance only handles a subset of the partitions, you will need that the data from your stream and your table are co-partitioned. So that means both topics have exactly the same amount of partitions, and the data on the topic has the same key. And the same partition logic. Usually, how Kafka divides your data across the partition is based on just the key, but you can implement some advanced logic. So as long as data is on the same partition, then you can join the table. There is an exception. You also have a global k-table. In the case of the global k-table, each instance of your application not just gathers one partition or two partitions, but all of the partitions. So if you have a relatively small data set and you can choose to just gather all the data from all the partitions and then... sorry about that. in that case, you can join this data without making sure the stream has the same amount of partitions and the same keys. So if we look at this code example, we do a left join. Let's read it. in this case, we need to check. This is a real world example from our code. We need to check whether the party that's requesting data is actually authorized. So we have a global k-table, and the data there is which market parties are authorized to retrieve metadata. So in this case, we have incoming request on the stream, and we have a table with all the parties, and by joining the stream with the table, the result of the join is a tuple, and you implement a method that processes the tuple. In this case, I create an authorization result object that consists of whether this, the request, the original request, and whether the request is indeed authorized. Well, then you have a stream with objects that can tell whether they are authorized. You could filter out the not authorized request. You could also do a branch. So in this example, we split the authorized and the non-authorized requests, and that way you get an array of streams. The first instance in the array is the authorized request, and the second instance is the not authorized request, and we can handle them differently. Sorry about that. A different example is joining two streams. It's a bit more complex. Still, we need to make sure the partitions are they're co-partitioned. Also, we need to take care of we need to think of a time window, because a stream can be up to an infinite amount of data, and comparing one stream to another and making sure joining this on keys, you will need to consider a subset of the data. So you can say only look at the last 10 minutes or one day, or and it works both ways. So if you join data from coming in on the one stream, it can and later on the other stream, or the other way around. So on the right stream and later on the left stream. So you have two time windows to configure. To make sure your data is co-partitioned, this little example uses the select key operation. In this case, my stream of collected my stream of metering requests is mapped. Select key is sort of a map operation, but only changes the key, not the value of the message. So then we change the key, and when the key changes, you also need to write it to a new topic. And that's where the through operation comes in. You can do to or through. Then the stream is written to another topic. The through operation is a little bit different. In that case, the result of that operation is another stream you can use. It's not entirely necessary to use this operator. You can also just do a select key and move on. But then you don't have control of how your what the topic name is. Kafka can do this underwater for you, but in this case we want to name our topic. So we force every message that came in to be written on the next topic with a different key and therefore with a different partition. So in that situation we can join this with the metering request, the meter data. So we have requests coming in and meter data on the other stream, and if we have data, we can can pass that on in a process. So in this example, you see a left join. You join one stream with another stream. You also need to provide a join mechanism to combine the two, and also the join window. And after that, we can do another branch, whether there's indeed meter data or not. So this may be a little bit abstract in the code, so I've also made an example. So we have incoming requests, and we have available meter data, and this is the result of the join. So when a request comes in and there's no meter data for that meter, the result is another empty request. In that case, it's a trigger for us, okay, we need to start another process to collect the meter data from the meter, so it's sent to the meter the company maintaining the meter, and they collect it, and when they pass the data back in, then we can join the data. So if another request comes in, well, the result is the same. So after a while, a few hours it can take, the meter data is collected. In that case, the meter data is joined with the earlier, if the time window allows, of course, the earlier requests that came in. So in this example, there were already two requests outstanding. When the meter data comes in, it's joined with both of the requests for that meter, and the result is two messages: one for the one meter, one request, and one for the other request. but with the included meter data. If a third request for the same meter comes in, the meter data is already there, so we join the other way around and we get another request fulfilled with meter data. These were the examples of the Streams API. We also chose to run the Streams applications themselves on Spring Boot. One of the reasons was we were already choosing Spring Boot for some other applications in our landscape, some other services. So it's more similar that way. It's more easy for developers to get started. And of course, you can use all these nice features from Spring. We also use the health endpoints from Spring Boot Actuator, etc. Okay, one other thing. If you run a Kafka Streams application, the stream application itself needs to be shut down. So in our case, whenever our Spring Boot application is stopped, it gets a signal to shut down. We also need to shut down our Streams application, and this piece of code is added to each application we write. So after start, when we create a stream, we also add a shutdown hook. The other thing, the health endpoints. Every Kafka Streams application we build also get a health endpoint to be used in Kubernetes. So Kubernetes does some polling whether your application is already started and when it started, if it's still running correctly. And the default health endpoint can check whether the application as a whole is running, but it not necessarily means the Kafka stream is still running. We ran into some issues, for example, when there's an exception in processing a single message, then that thread stops working, and the thread handling that partition is the partitions that were handled by that thread are now handed over to other threads or other instances of our application. So the Kafka Streams application switches to a rebalancing mode. And when it's rebalancing, it's redividing the work, the partitions across the available nodes. So in some cases, if you add another instance or you shut down an instance, then the rebalancing will take maybe 30 seconds and then the work continues. But in the case of an exceptional message, a message that breaks the stream down, the message is handed over, the partition is handed over to the next instance that also tries the message. It also gets the exception, and that way it continues into all available instances are dead, and the Kafka Streams application gets stuck into rebalancing. So that's why we need to check the state of our Kafka stream. Is it still running or is there something wrong? If it's wrong, Kubernetes will detect it. We will see that in our reports and we can take action. Also, Kubernetes will restart the instance automatically if the health endpoint fails for too many times. So the first piece of code is checking the state from the Kafka stream. And this part of the code is the Spring Boot actuator health indicator component. And so this way you can hook it into Spring Actuator and you get it automatically on your health endpoint provided by Spring Boot Actuator. So some interesting things we learned from using Kafka Streams. One thing is your stream application gets real high performance. First tests we did, we got, the requirement was handling 100,000 requests per hour. And our first test was showed tens of thousands of requests per second. So it fulfilled the performance needs quite brilliantly. Except for some parts where we need to invoke external services. So in that case, you're not able to use the internal state of the Streams application and get this high throughput. If you need to do a call to a web service, for example, and the web service can take a half a second to respond, then your throughput gets very limited. So invoking these external services can be killing for your performance. You can of course add more partitions and more streams and instances to do that more in parallel, but in the end you will get to a certain point where there's a limit in your the external service you're calling. So you could do 100 requests in parallel, but does the servers cope with that? So for the streams applications that need to keep in the state because of the joins, you will need quite some off heap memory to cache the data from the for the local RocksDB data. Also, when running multiple partitions, each partition gets some memory for the messages that are fetched. So if you do multiple partitions on one instance, you need some heap space for that. So now we're running momentarily with 2 or 3 gigabytes of heap and another 2 gigabytes of non-heap memory available on our containers. So it depends on your application. So for now, this works for us. Aggregates is another thing we didn't get entirely working the way we wanted it. An aggregate, in this case, you combine data in a time window. So for example, we need to create a batch of requests we can send out again to the people that ask for the data. So for example, we need a time window of 5 minutes. So every message that comes in 5 minutes for the same party that requested it is grouped to a batch message. Only Kafka Streams can do that. It can have aggregates with a time window of 5 minutes, but it does a periodic commit. So if you, default is, I believe, 30 seconds, so it's committing a piece of the aggregate after 30 seconds, so there may be one or two messages. After 1 minute again, then with another message, some messages again, and then 1.5 minute. But all these messages are added. So in the end, we get a message with 5 minutes of data, but the other messages in between are a subset of the aggregate, and that's not what we want. We want only the last one. So we didn't use this function. We built something ourselves. Unit testing your code it can be done fine, but unit testing the actual setup of your stream logic, it was very hard to get working with mocks and things. So in the end, we chose to do some unit testing of most of our code, and if the stream works entirely, we just did some deployment of the entire stream application and do input and output testing of the application by just putting data on the topic and reading from another topic in our tests. We used Cucumber to write those tests. Also, getting data from Kafka is, well, it's a stream of data. You cannot search in that stream easily. So if you want to do some look, if you want to look into your data on the topics, you will need some external tooling to do that. So, Sander is going to tell about how we do that with Kafka Connect.
Okay. So, techniek. Mag ik weer? Ja. Thank you, Jeroen. I'm going to talk a bit about Kafka Connect. So, we use Kafka Connect to get the data from Kafka into Elasticsearch. Like Jeroen already mentioned, you have some GUIs for Kafka, on which you can search your messages, but the interface is not very nice. You can't search, you just have your log, and then you're browsing through all the messages, and that's not what you want. So we export all the data from Kafka into Elasticsearch, and Elasticsearch is also our auditing log, and it's also the main data source for our business GUIs. So our business is also using Elasticsearch, so we have one backend with all our data, which is, so it's basically a view on that Kafka data. And Furthermore, it's also useful for our development and for our ops. So you can search your messages. You can also use Grafana and Kibana to get interesting statistics out of your data. So what does it look like? Kafka Connect, like I mentioned, it's similar to Fluentd or Logstash. So it also has a bit of similar configuration. So you mentioned which topic you want to read. You mentioned the connector, your name, your connection URL. We use Avro as a messaging format. And you and we also use, because we use Avro, we're also using the schema registry. And you also have to specify that endpoint. And over here, you can also see the service discovery mechanism of Kubernetes, because these are the real endpoints. So you only have to spy schema registry or Elasticsearch, and Kubernetes will resolve that DNS for you. And like Fluentd and Logstash, Kafka Connect also has messaging transformations. And these are very useful, because normally it will only send you your payload. And there are some aspects from the metadata from events that you would like to have in your message. For instance, what is the time my message is enqueued on a topic? So you can have some statistics about it. That is. And furthermore, what we also do is we rewrite the name of the Elasticsearch index we put the topics in. And this is very useful if you want to prefix all your Elasticsearch indexes so you can search through them more easily. Okay, well, keep in mind, Elasticsearch from version 6 will only allow one mapping type per index. So what you normally would do with Logstash, you would have one index in which you will gather all your data. So you have logs from Apache, from a Java application, etc., etc. You will have that sliced and diced per day, but everything will be in one index, and it won't be supported in the future versions of Elasticsearch. So use one index per topic. And it's also the default that is used by the Confluent container of Elasticsearch. So what we further can do, Kafka Connect can also handle the mapping type for you. So if you're using Elasticsearch, you have to tell me, this is type string, this is type number, or this is a timestamp. We choose not to use the mechanism of Kafka Connect, because, well, at the moment there was a bug in the connector, it wasn't feasible to work with Elasticsearch 5, and for the murder mapping for the date time was quite difficult. So what we have done, we have made a Elasticsearch mapping template to say, well, this is the date time, it is specified in milliseconds, and it will be interpreted by Elasticsearch as a date time. Keep note that templates are stored on the master, and if you're like us, you're running Elasticsearch in a cluster with separate masters, you need to have them, need to use persistent volumes for them, because otherwise your templates will get lost. And it's it was a fun way to discover where it was coming from. So how does it look like? This is an entry from Kibana. At the top, you can see the ID. This is how we specified. At the end, you can see our connector has added the partition and has also added the offset. And this way, our connector will ensure messages are only added, exist once in Elasticsearch. Like we mentioned, Kafka is an at least once mechanism. And using this principle, you can get exactly once to get your messages in Elasticsearch. So if you do aggregates or something else on your messages, you will get the proper results. So, like we already mentioned, we're using Kafka streams and we deploy them on Kubernetes. There are also a lot of other ways to deploy it. It's basically a jar. You can deploy it on whatever you like. Well, and Kubernetes over here is very cool. So that's also what you think. Well, that's what we also want to be. So let me ask a question. Are there people over here who are using Kubernetes already? Not so many people who want to use Kubernetes. A bit more. And the people who are using it, are they happy using it? A bit shaky. Well, for us, we are very happy using Kubernetes. It has, like Jeroen already mentioned, it has some self-healing capabilities. We are using it in production for already in 1 year. It's so dynamic. If you want some extra resources, you can. It will add them automatically. And for Kafka and Kafka Connect, persistency is very important. So I'll talk a bit about the persistence layer in Kubernetes and how that is automated for you. So Kubernetes has a stateful set to do so, and it will ensure a unique network identifier. So if you use Kafka, your client will connect to your Kafka instance, and then it will discover what node your data is on, and then it will connect to that node. So if your network identifier is keep changing, so it will be Kafka XIZ 123, and it goes down and it will come up again, and it will be NIP 987, it's not very useful for your application. Furthermore, stateful sets make it possible to use persistent volumes in Kubernetes. I will talk about like this, and you have some features for audit deployment, getting your application up and rolling, rolling out deployments or rolling out a new version. It makes it very useful for you. So Kubernetes has volume extraction. What does it mean? Where you used to roll out a new volume in your infrastructure layer, you have to link it to a node. It's not very automatic. You have to do a lot of work, so Kubernetes has some things to make it for you. So first of all, there is the persistent volume type, and you can compare it with its EBS volume or a persistent disk. It really depends on your infrastructure layer. Then there is the persistent volume claim type. Persistent volume claim will bind to a persistent volume, so that volume that is really in your infrastructure will be tagged with a name in Kubernetes. Then the stateful set will create pods, and that pods will mount your persistent volume for you. If that pod will go down and come up on another node, Kubernetes will detach that volume from that node, attach it to the new node, and everything starts working and running again. So you have a complete self-healing infrastructure, and if my worker, my compute nodes go down, everything will come up again. So fully self-healing. What is also interesting, Kubernetes can do dynamic volume provisioning. So in my stateful set, I can specify I want 3 Kafka instances, and I want them to have, well, let's say 200 gigabytes of volume. Using dynamic provisioning, Kubernetes will create that volumes in your infrastructure and bind everything together. Depending on your storage class, you can define what kind of kind of storage you would like. So we're using AWS, and in AWS you have GP2 or IO optimized, and furthermore you can specify the zone. If you do not specify a zone, Kubernetes will spread your volumes over the zones that your cluster is using. So if you're using Kafka, you normally want to spread it across zone A, B, and C. So spread it across your data centers. If one goes down, you can still run happily ever after. So if you don't specify a zone, you can say, I want a stateful set, I want 3 instances, and Kubernetes will do the rest. Default way is if you delete a PVC, it will delete your volume on your infrastructure. If you delete a stateful set, it will not delete your persistent volume claim, and thus it will not delete your volume on your infrastructure layer. The reason this has been done is, well, we can imagine you throw some things away, but persistence is very important, so you might want to keep that a little longer. So, an example of a stateful set. People who have been using Kubernetes might be familiar with YAML files already. So at the top, we specify the kind. What is important, we have to specify the service name, and for the rest, it looks mostly the same like a normal deployment. Like I said, this is not an introduction to Kubernetes. I know not a lot of people have been using it. What you specify is mostly what's important. You specify the container you want to run, and at the bottom you specify what volume you want to mount in your container at what endpoint. Then it will continue because it won't fit. On one slide, you have the volume claim template, and the volume claim template specifies the storage class name you have, like the sample you have shown. You can specify how many storage you would like to request, and then it will be created automatically. So if you create With one stateful set, I will get pods running and volumes attached. So it will look like this in GUI. I will have Kafka nodes 0, 1, and 2. And if I look into my persistent volumes, I have Kafka data there 0, 1, and 2. You can also update stateful set, and it has two ways of doing so. It can do so automatically for you, or you can do it yourself. So you can update your definition, say I want to reuse this new version, or for instance, if you want to update Kafka or your Kafka Streams applications. So Kafka 1.0 has come out yesterday. If you're running 0.11, you might want to update it. However, your application has a lot of state. If you pull one out and bring one back, you lose, of course, some of your replication factor. So you might only want to continue if your replication factor has been restored, because otherwise you have downtime in your application. That might require some very advanced checks, so you might want to do that by hand. And that's called on-delete, rolling update. It will just check your health endpoint and your readiness endpoint to do so. So you're running Kafka Streams on Kubernetes. It makes us very happy because it is very resilient, very properly system. We have persistent volumes for our RocksDB, and they will be created automatically. However, keep in mind that not all Kafka Streams applications require a large volume. If you do not join a lot of data and you only do a bit of filtering or a bit transformations, you might not need stateful sets, and you can use the lighter way of deployments in Kubernetes. So having this all up and running, of course, you need to monitor. And we use Prometheus for it. It has a way of automatic service discovery. It can combine metrics, so you can detect consumer lag. It can do some alerting. We use a node exporter as a sidecar to monitor the disks. So you want to know if my Kafka disk is running full, you will get an alert for it. You have JMX agents and a library to get your metrics out of Kafka. We use Grafana for dashboarding. We use Jenkins for our CI, which is also running on Kubernetes. We use an opinionated shared library. So Jenkins, you can create your own library. It makes it easier, so you only have to include a very small sample. So wrapping up, things to remember, Kafka Streams is a powerful and elegant solution if you want to do a streaming application. Kubernetes is a great platform if you want to host Kafka Streams applications. It will make life a lot easier for you by doing a lot of things automatically. And Elasticsearch fit well in a Kafka-based solution.